Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Hi, I'm John Malis. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this Thursday morning. Glad you're with us. Our special guest in the studio today is an expert in the field. We're talking mental illness and can it be cured with prescription drugs. We're going to kind of combine the two. 436-METV, option 11. Very important topic today, so call in. By the way, our sponsor on this day is Charles Chuck McGill, that funny guy that was our guest on Monday. Back in just a moment. And welcome back to the program here on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno on this Thursday morning. I'm so glad you are here. Little programming note for tomorrow. Becky Sinema is going to be here to talk about the movies and much more. She's always a very entertaining person, to say the least. She makes me laugh. And Becky's been a regular here for many, many years, I think since the very beginning. Her and Dennis Hart, I think, hold the record for number of appearances here. And our guest today is rapidly closing in. Anyway, I want to ask you a question, my friend. You know, I looked at the paper today and I picked it up and I have to steal a phrase from one of the comics from last night, because they rolled the videotape of Ted Cruz and Carly Fiorina, and he posed the question, and look at the picture here, front page of the Fresno Bee. Now I want to ask you a question, the same question that Jimmy Kimmel asked last night. What in God's name are they celebrating? Why are they celebrating? Ted Cruz picked a perennial loser, a person who the voters rejected. They rejected Carly Fiorina. He's not even in the race. Has somebody told Ted Cruz yet that he lost five states on Tuesday? Every county and every state went to Donald Trump. I have no idea what's going on with that. That is just ridiculous. Anyway, today's program, we're talking about mental illness and prescription drugs. Okay, I had to get that off my chest because, I'm going to pin that up on my wall at home just to remind me how crazy politicians are. Anyway, I got to get to today's program, and it's mental illness and the impaired ability or the lack thereof to function in ordinary life. There's some 54 million Americans suffering from mental illness, and if you mix in prescription drugs and other drug medications, you know, the fact of the matter is you've had so many people, celebrities that have died through prescription drugs, and we don't know if it's tied to mental illness or not. I can bring up several. I'll bring up just a couple. Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston, Prince, I guess recently, within the last day or so, they found prescription drugs. We don't know if that was the cause of his death. But anyway, you know, recently it was also reported that John Kasich has a brother who suffers from mental illness. Now, take a look at this piece of videotape that includes Donald Trump, who won five states on Tuesday, talking about John Kasich. And then it's revealed that Kasich's brother is one of those 54 million Americans across the country who suffers from a mental disability.
I have never seen a human being eat in such a disgusting fashion.
Donald Trump's jaw-dropping attack on John Kasich's eating habits has everyone buzzing.
This guy takes a pancake and he's shoving it in his mouth. It's disgusting. Do you want that for your president? I don't think so.
You listen to Donald talk about how unpresidential John is eating, and yeah. How unpresidential are you being by pointing that out, yeah. Donald?
Yeah, exactly.
Now, details about a personal tragedy in Kasich's life are emerging as he attempts to stop Trump in Tuesday's important Northeast primaries. This man with hair way below his shoulders is Kasich's younger brother, Rick. He has bipolar disorder. We're now learning the brothers did not speak to each other for 19 years. He doesn't have much to do with me, and I don't have much to say about him. Rick Kasich tells today's New York Times.
No.
We caught up with him at his home outside Pittsburgh, but he wouldn't speak to us. Rick Kasich had a mental breakdown in 1975, his freshman year of college. His brother John went on to be a congressman and governor of Ohio, while Rick worked as a postal worker. The brothers broke off all contact soon after their parents were mowed down by a drunk driver in 1987. The governor and his troubled brother finally reconciled 10 years ago. We love Rick deeply and have shared the struggles that his disease brings with it, Governor Kasich says in a statement.
All right, live in our studio now is our resident family therapist. His name is Peter Nazaridian, or is it? 436-ME-TV, option 11. I'll tell you what that statement's all about later on in the program. We're here to talk about a very serious topic. If you want to call in and ask a question, you know, if you have a relative, like a cousin or a brother or maybe parents, a distant relative, perhaps that's living with you, that suffers from some kind of mental disability, mental illness, or whatever the case may be, call in, ask Peter. He's our expert today, 436-ME-TV, option 11. Today's program, sponsored by Charles Chuck McGill. Back in just a moment.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy to clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill, Guzman, McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Back here on the program, 436-ME-TV, option 11, mental illness, top of the mind today here on, well, everybody's mind here today on Connect With Me. Peter Nazaridian is here to talk about it. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, John. Always a pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah, mental illness. Now, let me ask you this, because I was thinking about this. Don't all of us suffer from some small fragment of mental illness? All of us. Don't we have some small fragment of that?
Probably. If nothing else, we all have traits of certain personality disorders, not enough to make it diagnosable, but traits and tendencies, and that comes out of our childhood, the way we were raised, the way we saw our father and mother operate. We pick up those pieces. We may not be dysfunctional with them, but we may have some habits and behaviors that can be aggravating.
Yeah, the inability to function in normal life. That's what mental illness is, if you were to describe it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Caller, you're on the line with Peter Nazaridian. Go ahead.
Yes. I wanted to know if sometimes some therapists or some psychiatrists, they're really quick to diagnose a person with a mental illness. Because for myself, you know what I mean, I'm 50 years old. My brother's 47. He recently went through a divorce. And, I mean, his daughter was 17, just barely going to be 18. And he used that as his, you know what I mean, he said he had a breakdown. And now his psychiatrist has told him, or whatever he's saying, that he's got to concentrate on himself. He's taking pills. And now his daughter was living in a car, you know what I mean, because his mom took, the mother took off. And so the daughter, she's only 17 or 18 now, but she was living in a car. I went and picked her up. She's living with me now. I'm taking care of her. I'm watching her. I'm taking, you know, making sure she's going to school and doing all the good stuff. But when I try to tell my brother, you know what, you know what I mean, can you help out? You know, I mean, your daughter needs certain things that, you know, I mean, I can provide her, but I need you to help out too. Step in. You're still around. But he comes at me telling me, oh, it's part of my thing, my therapy. I can't deal with that right now. And then he starts going into problems. And then, I mean, he lives at my parents' house. And then, any minute now, I expect my mom to start breastfeeding them again. You know what I mean? That's the point it's got to. And how can you,
God,
how can I know that I'm doing the right thing and this guy just ain't, you know what I mean, trying to go back to being a kid again and yeah, living the easy life. And it's really, you know, it's kind of pissing me off, but I don't care. I'll do what I got to do to make sure this little girl, you know, turns out okay. That's just my question. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for stepping in and helping out your brother's daughter. She's the one who needs some help, and it's a sad thing what's happening with him, but I appreciate that you're doing it. We're not quite sure what he's struggling with, unfortunately, but he says because of his therapy, he's incapable of it. He may think he's a bad father or have anger management issues or can't cope with the stress and anxiety of raising a child. I'm not sure what that could be, but I'm glad that a family member like yourself has stepped in. As far as being helpless, mental illness is a very debilitating situation. John mentioned a moment ago about John Kasich's brother being diagnosed with mental illness in his freshman year in college, which is about right. Now we're finding out he's bipolar. Onset of bipolar is late adolescence, early 20s. So he's probably 19, 20 years old, and that's a perfect onset. Mm-hmm. Up to that point, they're fine and dandy, and suddenly at 20 years old, they go sideways, and we're wondering what happened. Drugs or alcohol involved? Perhaps. That's the time of experimentation. But probably without the drugs or alcohol, they still would have gone off the rails because that's what's going on. To the extent that the family or friends step in to help out, as you have with his daughter, is a wonderful thing. And as far as him, you know, struggling, yeah, we don't know what's going on with that, but he may be helpless. I don't know about going back to mom's nurturing. That's a little radical, perhaps, but he may need that. And I don't mean to make light of it at all. It's just an interesting concept. But, yeah, he may actually be still 18 or 19 years old and desperately need to be helped out. So thank you for jumping in.
Okay, mental illness is the topic today. And how does that tie in with prescription drugs or drugs of any kind? We'll talk about that in a moment here. But I've been reading so much on the Internet about mental illness. And the fact of the matter is I saw one report that said, we don't know the cause of mental illness. And then I ran across something here that I'm going to read to you. You know, it's becoming more and more clear through research that many of these conditions are caused by a combination of genetic, biological, psychological, and environmental factors. Well, if we don't know the cause, how can they say this?
You're pretty much covering all the bases there. Because how do you delineate, okay, this is only because of genetics, this
right,
is only because of the way you were raised, this is only, you can't make those discrete delineations, unfortunately. So that's a good quote. It is a combination of various ingredients. Obviously, for some people, it's primarily one. In other cases, it's very obvious to see how a combination of genetics and environment have, you know, like with an abusive father, an alcoholic mother, something like this, is going to create a very difficult home situation. Even if a kid is fine, you know, can those constant input of aggravation, anger, alcoholism, abuse, can that work on a young mind? Sure it can.
It
obviously is a combination, yeah.
Yeah, but we know the cause then?
Well, in some cases we do. For example, with bipolar, schizophrenia, things like that, it is mostly genetic. There's a gene that comes down, and you know, chances are you're going to get it. Now, to the degree, is it a little bit or is it a lot? If there's four kids, do two of them get it and two of them don't? Does one of them, is it serious for one? Does it take a different form from another? I've seen all these.
Right. Hang on, caller. And there's several different types here, according to what I've read. Some of the types of depression include anxiety, schizophrenia, bipolar, mood disorder, personality disorders, trauma, eating disorders. Is an eating disorder a mental illness?
It can very well be. For example, if a child is molested as a mm-hmm. child, they almost always develop an eating disorder later in life. Doesn't mean that's the only way it happens. I'm just saying that's a direct link.
Yeah. Caller, go ahead.
Yes. Last month I lost my son, and he had mental illness, and he was put on a lot of drugs. I'm just wondering if the drugs have anything to do with wanting him to kill himself.
Oh, boy.
First of all, I'm very, very sorry for your loss. It's the most tragic loss we can have is to lose a child. So my heart goes out to you. To answer your question, you know, can a combination of prescription drugs contribute? There's no definitive answer. Possibly. You're trying very hard to control it, and sometimes the very medications you put on board to try to control it can contribute. Not that that's the intention at all, not that that's the scope of it, but oftentimes they'll tell you, for example, in the package insert for antidepressants, they'll tell you that, you know, suicidal thoughts can be a part of this. Why? It's a little bit murky. We're not quite sure why that is. Sometimes I think people get so much in touch, they'll take an antidepressant, which we can talk more about how that works later.
Yeah.
You take an antidepressant and they get clarity. And suddenly they get really in touch with how screwed up their life is, and that can be overwhelming. So in some ways, understanding the situation they're in can be overwhelming.
Yeah. My thoughts and prayers to the caller, too. Are you there? Still there?
Yes.
Yeah. My thoughts and prayers out to you and your family. It's like Peter said, it's the worst thing to lose a child. How are you coping? How are you coping now?
Not really good.
Mm-hmm. Are you in need of help? Do you need assistance?
I don't know.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said, I don't know. I just know I miss you a lot.
Right. Well, you know, Peter's going to give out his number. If you'd like to come in and talk to Peter, maybe he can help you out a little bit. Peter, why don't you go ahead?
Sure. The number is 252-9700. I'm with Fig Garden Counseling Center. We've been in town here over 25 years. And we have several therapists, and it doesn't have to be me. But if you feel like talking to somebody would be helpful on this and try to sort this out, please give us a call, and we'll try to figure that out. Again, 252-9700. And thank you so much for your call.
Hello? Are you still there?
What's the number? Yes.
It's 252
9700.
9700. 252 9700.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other thoughts that you can add to maybe comfort her?
That's a hard one. The most difficult loss we have is the loss of a child. Our loss of grandparents and parents, we sort of expect. It's never pleasant or fun, but we expect that's the rotation.
Yeah.
Even to lose a spouse, we do have a formula in the grief and loss process that says when you lose a spouse, someone you've chosen to be with you, how long does it take to get over the loss of a husband or a wife or a sweetie? And the answer is roughly, there's a formula that says about 1 month per year.
Yeah.
So if you're married 20 years, you can expect it's going to be about 20 months before you actually start to bounce back. But for a child, there is no statute of limitations.
What about guilt feelings? Like, I could have done more. How do you talk to a person and try to console them and comfort them?
That's a very hard one, because guilt is something we feel. I should have. Why didn't I? I could have done something. And, you know, maybe in some ways there's something to that. Maybe they could have been more loving or kind or attentive or something. And
yeah.
So sometimes that guilt is legitimate. I hate to say it.
Yeah. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, what does he think about, the state administering drugs to people who have committed crimes and sending them to a Tuscadero or where they send them, getting them all lucid again, getting them back into reality, just to convict them and for something they don't even remember doing? That's my question.
Yeah, what kind of mental illness is that when they commit a crime, they don't remember it?
Well, it's a little bit like saying, you know, I'm drunk driving and I go through a crosswalk, hit a kid on a bike and kill him, and I say, oh, well, I don't even remember doing it. I was drunk.
But it's possible, right?
Well, sure. But that's not, unfortunately, we can't use that as an excuse.
No,
You take responsibility for what you do no matter what your state of mind is. So, you know, much like a DUI, what is the best way in the world to absolutely guarantee you'll never get a DUI?
Don't drink and drive.
It'll never happen. Yeah. So unfortunately, when somebody decides to take drugs of any kind or alcohol or whatever it might be, whatever those consequences, and those inserts there, you've seen them, they're tiny printing and they're this big. They tell you everything that could go wrong. How many people read those? Almost nobody. We just do it. And unfortunately, depending on the person, sometimes the amount and the specific type of drug can be very, very debilitating. So know what you're doing. Don't put it in your body if you can't handle it.
Right. We're going to take a commercial break here. Our sponsor today, Charles Chuck McGill, an attorney at law, more than 25 years. Glad he is our sponsor. 436 MeTV Option 11. Mental illness is the topic today, a very important one. Back in just a moment.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Frigidaire Gallery appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Time for that upgrade to an Energy Star qualified French door Frigidaire Gallery refrigerator. Quality appliances for the way you live. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
You know, when you consider there's, roughly 350 million people in this country, 54 million of those suffer from mental illness. That's about roughly a fifth, I guess. I'm not good at math.
Seventh, actually.
Something like that. So there are more than 200 classified forms of mental illness. More than 200. Who came up with this formula, 200?
There's a diagnostic manual that we use to diagnose mental illness called the DSM. And in that are literally almost anything you can think of in terms of what might be a mental illness. And this has been, for years and years, has been published. The new one came out last year, the DSM-5. So this is the diagnostic manual is where they come from.
Yeah. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yeah, I just called. And maybe I said my question wrong. What I was referring to was people with a mental illness that for some reason or other, they turned 18, they're no longer under the care of somebody that's going to pay for their meds, and they're sent out to the street, and then they do commit a crime, and, you know, then they go and they say, okay, because you weren't taking your meds, now we're going to give you your meds, we're going to take care of you, we're going to get you healthy, and now we're going to convict you. I mean, that's what I'm talking about. Not the guys who go drink and drive or do drugs, they get what they deserve, but no, I mean, this happened to my cousin, and he had no recollection of it. Everybody knew he had schizophrenia and everything, but the next thing you know, they put him back on his meds, he's good to go, he's real cool. And they start convicting, they start throwing crimes at him that he really didn't know he did, or he had no control of doing. And I mean, he's on his meds now, and I go visit him, and he's full of heads. He's like normal. He's like, I don't even know what he.
Okay.
When we talk, he tells me I still don't know why I'm here.
All right.
But that's my question.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a little difference. I spent about 13 years in a psych hospital as a therapist. And in that time, saw lots of people with schizophrenia, and it's a very remarkable thing with that particular disorder. They will come in, you know, swearing to the Queen of England, getting messages from Venus through the fillings in their teeth, and a few days later, on the right medication, they're as lucid as you and I. So it's just a matter of, you know, the medication. The bad news with schizophrenia is it doesn't take much to get them off their meds, and it doesn't take much once they're off their meds to go right back to the side. A new thing has come out where they give them a shot about once or twice a year, and then they don't have to worry about getting off their meds, just get that shot once or twice a year. So we're making progress. Now, the question is, when they're debilitated by the mental illness and they commit a crime and they get back on drugs and don't remember it, unfortunately, like the example I gave you about the drunk, when you commit a crime on, you know, of any kind, you take responsibility for it. So, unfortunately, you have to do that.
Yeah. Another call coming in. Good morning. You're on the air. Go ahead. Caller.
Peter, let me ask you a question. This happened about 10 years ago. You're talking about mental illness and all that. But what happened was, you know how ice cream trucks have music and in that area that this happened, you know, kids dart across the street and all that. And the father was supposed to be watching him, and for 5 or 6 seconds, he looked the other way, and the son took off. He was 5 years old at that time. This happened 10 years ago, but after the accident, he was killed because he was hit by another car, and the car was coming pretty fast. And anyway, he snapped, and he lost control of reality. In other words, you know, I mean, I guess he felt it was his fault, and he could not function anymore in life, you know, and he just deteriorated. I mean, after, you know, seeing his son get killed, but is that also like a mental issue? Because you know, he saw what he saw, and he couldn't cope with it. He left the house, left the family, everything, and nobody knows where he went. So. I just wanted to find out if that the drawback as far as, you know, seeing someone, especially a son when he was 5, he would have been 15 now. But man, I would probably be doing the same thing. But that's what I want to know, Peter.
Yeah, thank you for your question. Yes, it probably does qualify as a mental illness. In that story, without knowing more details, it sounds like the guilt was just crushing for him. And the, you know, who knows what the family, if they let him off the hook or if they blamed him, and that would just add to it. So it sounds like that crushing responsibility and guilt made him snap. He just couldn't cope anymore. He couldn't face anybody. He couldn't face himself. So, yes, mental illness, absolutely. And sad for that.
Let me read you a couple of things that I found on the internet. And it says that this is what you can attribute mental illness to as far as adults and young adults are concerned. Confused thinking, that's one. Prolonged depression, sadness, irritability, social withdrawal, strong feelings of anger, strange and delusional thoughts, inability to cope with problems and daily activities, changes in ability to manage day-to-day responsibilities like paying bills and whatever. For younger kids, for school kids like toddlers, changes in school performance, poor grades despite strong efforts, frequent temper tantrums. All of the above true?
Yeah.
They are.
Yeah. Yeah, they're not all the same mental illness, but you're describing symptoms of a wide variety of mental illness, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, let's do this. Put up the first one on the screen, the one that has two screens on it. The first one, talking about drugs, because there are all sorts of drugs that are out there on the market that people are taking now for mental illness. And one of them is Prozac. I know that, right? I mean, that's a very common one that's been around for years.
The original gold standard from 1985, yeah.
Yeah, and so talk a little bit about what you're seeing here. Can drugs cure mental illness? Leave that one up there for a while so we can kind of read that, and then we'll switch it, R, to the next screen.
Okay, let's answer that question directly. Can drugs cure mental illness? No. No, they do not. They do not cure. They manage, they control, but they do not cure.
A doctor can't come along and inject you with some kind of fluid, either in your brain or in your body, to cure.
That's correct.
Your problem.
That's correct. You cannot.
Because?
It's not a chemistry thing. Mental illness is about the brain not operating correctly. There's no injection you can get to make your brain operate right. You can control it. For example, if somebody's flagrantly mentally ill, we can give them enough medication to calm them down, but that doesn't cure the issue. It just makes them not act out.
Okay, so what we're seeing here is pretty much true, right?
Yeah.
Medicines are usually more effective when combined with psychotherapy.
There is, anecdotally, in our business for many, many years, it has been widely researched that drugs can help manage mental illness. Psychotherapy can help manage mental illness, depending on the degree and the type. But nothing is more effective than the combination. Neither one is as effective alone as they are together.
Okay, medications may alleviate some significant symptoms. Mm-hmm, then talk therapy is also, I guess, helpful, right? Mm-hmm, talk therapy. Mm-hmm, and how does talk therapy help somebody?
Well, let's say somebody hypothetically is depressed. And let's say they're depressed where a combination of clinical, they have it, the family gene, and they happen to be in a destructive, abusive relationship. The medication can help control the mental illness, the depression symptoms, not wanting to get out of bed, not wanting to be very active, not finding much pleasure in activities, that sort of thing.
Okay.
That can be alleviated somewhat. As far as the difficult situation they're in, what may have caused it, with the situation they're living in, talk therapy can help that, giving options of changes to manage their situation.
So it can actually help change those negative thought patterns?
Yeah.
No, all right. Well, what does it mean, Peter, before we change it to the next one? Because I hear this all the time, and we joke about it. I've joked about it, too, so I'm guilty of the same thing. You know, you look at somebody and you say, you know what? You have a chemical imbalance in your brain. Okay, you've heard that a million times over.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Is it true?
Yeah.
It is true.
Yeah.
So it's a chemical imbalance?
It's a chemical imbalance. That's a nice way to put it. Mental illness basically is chemistry gone awry.
And you can't fix that chemical. You can't put another chemical to counterbalance that?
Well, that's the concept behind, for example, antidepressants, what they call SSRI, selective
right.
serotonin reuptake inhibitors. The idea is to affect the chemistry in such a way that it becomes more normal. More normal. It's not going to magically change it because the brain is an imprecise instrument. It's so complicated, we can't be that specific about it.
All right. Do any of these drugs help, or is it psychological? Gee, I'm taking this drug. It must be helping. I got to keep taking it.
Well, a little bit of both, John. I think, as I mentioned earlier about schizophrenia, I've seen remarkable turnarounds in just a matter of a couple of days from somebody who takes a medication, and suddenly they're talking as lucid as you and I might be right now, assuming that's the case.
Right.
Or they, you know, it's so severe that it takes more and more drugs. But for most people, that maybe have a clinical depression, they take an antidepressant, they feel better. And a little bit later on, if we have a moment, I'll sort of explain how antidepressants work, so because a lot of people don't even know.
All right. Put the second one up on the screen. Can drugs cure mental illness? There it is, right there. Drugs cannot cure mental illness. Rather, they work to control many of the most troubling symptoms. Mm-hmm. Explain that.
Yeah, if for example, let's take the most common one, depression. I don't want to get out of bed. I don't want to go to work. I have a young person right now in my practice who doesn't want to go to school. Just can't get out of bed for days at a time. So these are the symptoms that with a medication can control and give them that motivation and energy.
All right, and we got to go to break, and so we'll come back and talk about the rest of this in just a moment. 436-ME-TV, option 11. Mental illness is the topic of the program today. Very complex issue for obvious reasons. I mean, my goodness sakes. We're going to be back in just a moment after this from Charles Chuck McGill. He is our sponsor today on the program.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
Talking about mental illness, let's put that graphic up on the screen, that same one before we went to break, and continue talking about that. Put that up on the screen there. And where do we leave off there, Peter?
We were talking about the symptoms of being able to control something as simple as depression,
right,
may be able to alleviate some of those. Something more serious, like bipolar or schizophrenia, of course, different medications. With schizophrenia and some forms of bipolar, you would use an antipsychotic. For depression, use an antidepressant. For anxiety, use an anxiolytic. So it just depends on what the mental illness is.
Why do drugs work for some people and they don't work for others? Because I see the graphic there, it says, you know, about drugs, it often enables people with mental disorders to return to a kind of a normal life, I guess you would say, but maybe not fully functioning, but at least partially.
There are so many moving parts in this equation. What is the mental illness? What is the chemical imbalance? What is the degree of severity? What is the coping mechanisms for that person generally? What is their environment? So many factors contribute to how well a drug might work for any individual that it's almost impossible to put a definitive point on it.
All right, got a call here and see what this is all about. Good morning, caller. You're on the air with Peter Nazaridian. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a question for Peter.
Mm-hmm.
My son just got, he works on a pump truck. And he got his, he bumped his head real hard. And his brain was bleeding. It was swelled up. And anyway, he's always had an anxiety problem.
Yeah.
Now, the doctor was giving him painkillers, and he got hooked on those. So, so he went to go take that. What you come off of?
Like rehab.
When you're on painkillers.
Mm-hmm.
Hello.
Yeah, we're here. Go ahead. We're just listening. Go ahead.
Okay. So I was wanting. Now he's on that drug that. The drug that you come off the painkillers with, and also he's on anti-anxiety medication. I'm just wondering if those two, it doesn't seem right to me, if those two are good for him, or if it won't even hook him up even more on drugs.
Yeah, that's the problem. Getting his brain was bleeding. They gave him a pain medication because it was hurting, obviously, and he got hooked on the pain medication. So yes, now theoretically, probably on Suboxone, I would just assume is the medication you're on, or he was on. And you know that's kind of like methadone to heroin. It's a synthetic version of it. Yeah. And if it's methadone, then, you know, then unfortunately they get hooked on that as well in some cases. But to give them an anti-anxiety medication, most of those are also addictive. So I can see that what your dilemma is. Are we giving them medication, then giving them something to get off the same medication? Are we just in an endless loop here without knowing what the treatment is, what the medications are? I'm kind of talking in the dark. But conceptually, yeah, it sounds like it could be an awkward situation.
Go ahead, caller. Anything else?
Thank you very much. Answer my question.
You know, the caller brought up something very interesting because that was part of the topic of our conversation today before we use any other graphics. And that is, if you're mentally ill and you start taking drugs and then something happens, like, you know, this guy's talking about his son, which is totally tragic, then you start taking other medications like prescription drugs, maybe painkillers, whatever.
Yep.
Now the addiction kicks in. And I talked in the monologue about so many of these entertainers that we've seen, and you don't have to be an entertainer. I'm just using that as an example because of all the publicity that these people have generated. The Michael Jackson case, obviously, Whitney Houston, and alcohol is a drug, is it not?
That is, absolutely.
Okay, and now we're hearing in the last day or so about Prince. They found prescription drugs, although we don't know yet. You know, they did an autopsy. We don't know the results. We won't know for another 2 weeks, maybe a month out, maybe even longer, if that was actually the cause. So what is the danger of being mentally ill or even a person who is not mentally ill, and then all of a sudden, bam, you're addicted to something because you had a knee injury or you had a brain injury or you broke your arm and now the darn thing hurts and it won't go away. Now I'm hooked on some painkiller.
We have a huge problem in this country with prescription medications. In the state of Florida, for example, where you can literally go to a strip mall and sign up and get drugs almost on the spot.
Really?
Yeah. There are more deaths from overdose of prescription medications in Florida than every other cause of death combined. In some of the rural states of Kentucky, huge drug problems because there's so abject poverty, so they use drugs. In those places, OxyContin is known as hillbilly heroin because they just get loaded. What we're talking about here is self-medicating. I don't like my life. I don't like my situation. I don't like my spouse. I don't like my job. I don't like life. But if I take, you know, two in the mouth, for 3 hours, I don't care.
Yeah.
And many medications like OxyContin, like anxiolytics, not for everybody, of course, but can be addictive in as little as 3 days.
All right, let's go to another call here. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Crank that baby up. Go ahead.
Peter, let me ask you a couple of questions. Can little children, let's say 2 or 4 years old, being abused, I'm not talking about sexually, but I'm talking about verbally, year after year after year, they get to the point where their mind is, you know, they're small, and their minds are already kind of brainwashed from yelling at them. They, you know, some of the parents want them to excel or whatever. So this goes years and years and years to a point where they're at a stage where mental illness takes over. And number two, you were talking about prescriptions. Well, a lot of doctors, they'll hear the patient what problem he has, a knee problem or whatever, and they prescribe a lot of Vicodins and all that. So young kids, when they go into the cabinet and they know the value of Vicodins or whatever it is, and they'll take a lot of those prescriptions because the grandparents or whoever, they don't know anything too much about it. But those two things are very important. A lot of physicians, I'm not saying all of them, but a lot of them, give them just to kind of ease their pain. But for those children, is that a mental thing? I mean, can that arise from that, from all that abuse of negative as they're growing up? That's my question to you.
Okay. Thank you. You've opened up several good topics in that one question, but thank you very much. Of course, it's a real issue with very young children, toddlers, let's say 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old in those early years. We're not quite sure what the long-term effects of some medications are. So even if a child is showing certain symptoms, mm-hmm. do you want to give them medications that may alter a growing brain in a way that may not be good 20 years down the road? Yes, that's an issue. Another thing you mentioned, if you yell at a child or traumatize them verbally, maybe even physically, if not sexually, you know, can that change the brain? Yeah. Yeah, we're finding out
well,
that
how young could the child should or could the child be?
An infant.
What about a teenager?
Sure, sure. With a teenager,
I've yelled at my kids.
Let's go back to during the Cold War when Russia was divesting itself of its satellites. The orphanages in Romania and Bulgaria and these places didn't have any funding, so they literally would put children on blankets in the hallway and just let them lie there. That's all they could do. They were never touched. They were fed a few times a day, but they just laid there. Now, 20 and 30 years later, we're finding out these people have horrible attachment issues. So you don't have to brutalize a child. Just basically don't touch them, and you'll screw them up. Now, if you
what
yell
about
at
name
them,
calling?
Oh yeah, if you put them down. I mean, how many times do you have to tell a child they're stupid before they believe it? Once. And if you're telling your child, what's wrong with you? Why are you stupid? I told you to do it a different way. Chances are they're hearing the message on a regular basis. And there are some parents, who actually get a pleasure out of diminishing their children so they can feel better.
Well, I mean, but I've done that. I mean, not exactly what you said, but I've, you know, I see my kids doing something and I'll say, what are you doing? What are you doing? It's like...
that's different, though. Ask them what they were doing.
The way I say it, you know, what are you doing? Like,
if the implication
the implication is...
You're an idiot.
Are you nuts?
Yeah. You know. Now, depending on how it's said and how often it's said, that can be very debilitating. And yet, isn't that a situation we all find ourselves in with children? What are you doing? Because they're not doing it right. So, you know, we're not saying there's a magical way to do it here, but to use verbal aggression, to use negative terminology, to call them stupid or inept or anything else, of course you're going to set up in motion.
All right, one. I got a text message here. What about the drug Celexa? What does that do? Does that help mental illness?
Yeah.
It does. Yeah, what is it supposed to do, and is it addictive?
No. The Celexa is not addictive. It's basically one of those medications that, you know, calms down excess neuron activity, helps the serotonin flow in the brain better.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Celexa, does it help you sleep? Or
not necessarily. It's primarily used for an antidepressant.
It is. So it's kind of like Prozac.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in that sense, it's in the same category. Yeah.
It can be used long-term with no side effects?
Depends on the individual, but qualified, yes. People have been on Prozac, for example. Gold standard came out in 1985. I've got a client who's been on Prozac since 1985. Same dose, works just as well as it did the first day. The thing with antidepressants is it's not a tolerance. Unlike addictive medications, we have to keep taking more and more to get the same effect. Right. Once you find the sweet spot with antidepressants, it just stays there.
Yeah. Look, we get a blood test for everything. We go and get a blood test for our cholesterol. We go get a blood test to see if we have AIDS. We go get a blood test for this, that, and the other thing. Mm-hmm. Can we get a blood test to find out if we have a chemical imbalance in our brain?
Not specifically. There are things being developed now that are moving that more in that direction. Can we get a blood test that will, in fact, show a dysfunctional gene, a given tendency? A big thing's going on now is called iridology. They're actually looking in the iris of your eye to see systemic differences. Yeah, they can. Some of the things you just mentioned can be diagnosed by looking in your eye.
Is that right?
Yeah. When they say the eyes are the window to the soul, turns out they may be more accurate than not. That's not for everything, and it's not exactly a fine-tuned. But right now, that's one of the ways we're looking at diagnosing. Otherwise, it's basically self-report.
What do you make of somebody who can't look you in the eye when they're talking to you? Like, I'm looking at you in the eye right now. I don't have a problem with it.
Right.
But someone who looks away when they're talking and they kind of look back and they're looking like over the shoulder, but they're not looking at you directly.
Right.
Is that some kind of a sign?
Well, it's probably more of insecurity, a lack of self-esteem.
Okay.
You know, so are they related to mental illness? Yeah. But in and of itself, it's not an issue.
All right, got to take a break quickly. Running out of time here, and a lot more graphics to go through. Oh my God, where'd the time go? And we have a special surprise. Is Peter Nazaridian really Peter Nazaridian? That's what I want to know. 436 MeTV, option 11, my friends. You can't wait for that. Mental illness, the topic today. Charles Chuck McGill, our sponsor today. Back in a moment.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated BizTalk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV Guide.
Ventura TV Appliance Center. We're the save energy, save time, save money place. The Energy Star qualified number one rated high efficiency Cabrio from Whirlpool Place. You heard right. Right now, save big on select Whirlpool Cabrio laundry pairs and pay no interest when paid in full within 6 months. At the hometown low price, think outside the big box place. Since 1951, Ventura TV Appliance Center. We're working hard to be your place.
Sports is now on KVHF 4.3.
Retro TV, your home for classic television. The greatest shows in history are here for you to enjoy. Join Cosby and Culp as secret agent men in I Spy. Ride along the Ponderosa with the Cartwrights in Bonanza. Hit the beat with Joe Friday in Dragnet. And that's not all. Retro TV offers endless fun and excitement for the whole family to enjoy. Retro TV, the best in classic television.
You can find Retro TV on over-the-air channel 13.4.
Back here on the program, Peter Nazaridian. Let's put another graphic up on the screen. It's called Doctor's Review, my friends. Doctor's Review, and it's a very interesting graphic that we're going to take a look at here. So we're talking about medications may work better for one person and not another. We talked about that before. What are we talking about here in terms of clinical records, family history, and side effects? Are you talking about medications here?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, all right.
When a doctor is looking at a situation and they're going to try and diagnose and maybe medicate, number one, clinical records, is there any history for this patient? Were they put in the hospital for other things? Is there anything else in their clinical records that might give us an indication that they have a mental illness or something has gone wrong in their childhood or they had a disease or a debilitating situation of some kind? So check the records. Number two, family history. Oftentimes, if somebody struggles with, let's say, schizophrenia, I'll ask, is there somebody in your family who struggles with mental illness?
Mm-hmm.
And an interesting comment here, sometimes they'll say, well, not really. You know, my grandfather, you know, was an alcoholic, but, you know, we didn't have mental illness. What we're finding out is that oftentimes alcoholism in the family tree is indicating self-medication. You know, the old joke about, you know, in the 30s when you know, what happened, you went on, you lock on Clara in the basement when company comes over because she's not right. That's the version of it, that people just put enough alcohol on board, you know, they can control almost anything.
What do you make of Kasich and his brother not talking to his brother for 19 years because his brother had mental illness? I don't know if that was the reason, but
right. It
seems like John Kasich seemed to stray away from him and keep away from him for decades.
Yeah, we don't know. Did the brother just
be ashamed?
Yeah,
do you think
John is on a fast track and doesn't want to be pulled down by someone with mental illness? It's entirely possible. On the other side of the coin, that the brother with mental illness didn't want a darn thing to do with him either, for a variety of reasons. So this may have been mutual. It may not have been John at all.
Yeah, let's put the next graphic up on the screen. It's called Mental Illness in Children. Many drugs used to treat mental disorders in adults also used to treat the same illness in children.
Yeah.
However, doctors often reduce the doses given in those children because of their size, obviously.
Yeah, to some extent, but there was a last one on the last graphic with side effects, and that's one of the reasons we'll drip it over to this one. Yes, there are side effects. Obviously, you want to be very careful of the amount of medication. Plus, with a child, you're dealing with a growing brain. And if you're adding chemicals to a growing brain, what's the effect of that long term? Well, we're not 100% sure of that right now.
Yeah.
So you want to be very careful of what you add into a growing brain for fear that you may, you know, affect the growth in some way.
All right, the next graphic, it's called Mental Illness That Responds to Medication. These are all the illnesses that respond to certain medications. Let's put those up on the screen now. Depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, schizophrenia, And the last one there, I can't read that.
ADHD.
ADHD, okay.
Yeah. These, there are medications for all of these. Probably the soggiest one is post-traumatic stress disorder, because that's a combination of are they depressed, are they anxious.
Military people got that.
Yeah, yeah. But PTSD can come from a rape. PTSD can come from an auto accident. PTSD can come from a horrible divorce. It's just a trauma. You know, we associate it with war, but it can happen in everyday life quite easily. A child coming out of a very abusive household can have PTSD.
Right. Let's put the next graphic up real quick here. Mental illness drugs. Let's put that one up and kind of dissect this one here. All right, you can take a look at the list here and go through them if you would, Peter.
Okay. Antidepressants, known as SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, fancy schmancy term for antidepressant, of course, treats depression. Anti-anxiety medications, anxiolytics, are going to deal with anxiety. By the way, anxiety and depression are two sides of the same coin. You can't have anxiety without depression. You can't have depression without anxiety. So it's a matter of which presents more. Antipsychotics deal with things like bipolar and schizophrenia, mood stabilizers more for bipolar, and stimulants are going to be for ADHD.
Yeah, interesting list there. Interesting, to say the least. Put the next one up. Most common issues that we can associate mental illness with: anxiety, depression, grief loss. Obviously, divorce, right? That's what that one means there. Yep. Family relationships. If you're on the outs with your sister, if you're on the outs with your parents, you're on the outs with a cousin, your favorite uncle, all of a sudden,
this list
disappears or whatever.
Yeah, this list, interestingly enough, it comes from the latest findings from the California Association of Marriage and Family Therapists, who do an annual survey about a snapshot of the average therapist. These are the issues that most therapists see in order of frequency.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what most people are going to counselors for. My practice has a little bit more. I deal with a more serious mental illness, so mine goes a little bit further than this, but. This is very typical. Anxiety, depression, grief and loss, very, very common. So the colleagues in my office see primarily people with these disorders.
Yeah, family relationships. I got to go to break here, and then we're going to come back and talk about something else here. But family relationships, would you say that's the most common, one of the most common reasons for people either they get into a depressive state, and they stay there for a long time, or is that the most common problem, is a family relationship, a divorce, you're on the outs with a family member?
Actually, the list, at the top of the list is depression. That's the most common. But family relationships are probably the underlying cause of an awful lot of that. If you're not getting along with your family, and by the way, that includes family of origin, what we call foo. If you had, how many times a young woman has an alcoholic father, well, who does she marry 20 years later? An alcoholic. Had a gal in the hospital, married four of them in a row. You think after the second or third one, she would have figured it out. But no, she had an alcoholic father, and she married four men, all of whom replicated the same dynamics.
Quickly, before we go to break, the drug called Valium,
mm-hmm.
a lot of people use it.
Yep.
Can it be used for depression?
Not a good idea. Valium is a depressant.
So if you take Valium,
you're going
to get depressed.
You could get more depressed.
Really?
Yeah.
Because?
Valium, it calms down. That Valium is more for anxiety. It settles things down. It pushes you down. It settles things down. So if you're taking it when you're already depressed, you're just going to go downer.
Wow. Okay. Got to go to break here. 436 MeTV, option 11. Let's see. Who's the sponsor today? That's right. Charles Chuck McGill, attorney at law, 25 years. How could I forget that? He was just on the program Monday. Back in just a moment.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Hello, I'm Peter Thomas, here to announce a new breakthrough in neckwear that'll surely boost your sales right off the charts. It's the new casual look that men the world over have been looking for, dressing up while dressing down. The new line is called Denim Down, and it's a neckwear line that is quickly catching the eye of business and fashion-minded people. Crafted in beautiful shades of denim, it allows your customers to dress for business or casual time while feeling relaxed. America has long had a love affair with denim. This basic cotton cloth first brought to America over 500 years ago. That's right, Columbus had sails made of this rugged and tough serviceable fabric. Long considered the most popular fabric for work clothes, Army and Navy uniforms, denim today has won great fashion significance in dress goods for women's and menswear, a wide range of sportswear, and even evening wear. With me now is noted fashion consultant Joseph. Joseph, is this new denim look going to catch on?
You know, I really think that it will. The primary reason is because I think the majority of the time people do not know what to wear with a pair of denim pants or a pair of khaki pants. You know, I find that a silk tie is a little bit too dressy for that kind of a look. But I think the denim look is going to catch on for that casual Friday.
No one in the industry has ever done the denim fabric in neckwear. This is the first. Since there's so much talk about casual Friday and the dress-down look, this denim tie fills that need perfectly. Mr. Frank Cornell, president of Cornell Neckwear of California. There have been many attempts to develop a tie that complements the truly casual dress-down look. Until now, no one has succeeded. This denim look, I believe, fills that gap. It looks great with the proper casual shirt and pants. Merchandised correctly for that casual Friday look, this tie should be a great success. Mr. Stephen Cornell, National Marketing Director and Design Coordinator for Cornell's of California. If you love ties like I do, you need to be wearing Denim Design 2000 Originals.
Well, it'd be very nice if you could explain what the heck that was.
who was that young, good-looking guy?
So is your name Thomas, or is it Nazaridian? Who is this guy?
That was the stage name, yeah. Who wants to listen to that name? Oh, my goodness.
Wow. Well, what year was that?
Who knows?
97.
Okay.
1997?
Okay. So 20 years ago?
19 years ago. Yeah, so...
And I haven't changed a bit. There's the good news.
No, there's no gray hair. There's nothing. No gray hair at all. And denim was in 1997.
That particular
apparently
store
so.
Was. I think they gave me that tie to wear. I don't think I would have worn that on my own. But it was
those denim ties looked horrible.
They shocked me here, folks. This is the first time I've seen this in 20 years. It was
is that
fun.
Shop still in existence?
I don't think so.
They're
I
out.
Know.
Huh?
I don't know.
Denim.
Don't know.
I mean, who wears denim now?
Maybe. You know.
Anybody wear? Does anybody wear denim?
Jeans, maybe, but ties?
No,
I mean,
ties and coats and shirts. And we all wear denim jeans, but I mean...
No, I haven't seen it.
Short-lived fad.
Wow. So tell us a little bit about your background then. You did commercials and...
Yeah, I've done a variety of
voiceovers.
Yeah, voiceovers. I stopped counting at about 1,500. You've heard of me a million times on different things, doing character voices and whatnot. So, yeah, I have a little history in theater and commercials on television and radio, so... There's the background, folks. It's diverse.
All right. We got 1 minute left. Getting back to the serious topic of mental illness, in 30 seconds, we're not going to solve anything in 30 seconds, but give out your phone number and also tell people quickly what they could do if they do feel they are mentally ill.
Best thing to do is get a consultation. Go to a mental health professional. A psychiatrist is fine. A therapist may help you understand what it is so it can be more clear. It might be a good idea to go to a therapist first. Figure out what's going on. Be honest, be open, be real. Can't help you if you don't do that. And if they feel like you might benefit from some medication, then you have to go to a psychiatrist who can prescribe. My phone number at Fig Garden Counseling Center is 252-9700. Again, 252-9700. But there's a variety of wonderful therapists in town. If you're comfortable with females or older or younger, all kinds of varieties available. Get some help, talk to a professional, and then get medication if you need to.
Yeah. It's that one-on-one connection that's very important.
Very
All right, Peter, good to see you.
Always
hey, no
pleasure,
denim
John.
Ties, not allowed here on the set.
Thank you, John. Always a pleasure and wonderful. Thank you for those wonderful questions today, folks. Look forward to doing it again.
Yep. Back tomorrow with Becky Cinema. She'll talk about the movies. 436 MeTV Option 11. If you want to leave a message, have a great day. See you tomorrow.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.